नमस्ते फ्रेंड्स, इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर आई डिस्कस्ड विद यू लीडिंग ट्रेलिंग ड्रम ब्रेक्स. वी सॉ दैट इन लीडिंग ट्रेलिंग ड्रम ब्रेक्स ब्रेक टॉर्क अवेलेबल एट लीडिंग शू इज लेस एज कंपेयर टू ब्रेक टॉर्क अवेलेबल एट ट्रेलिंग शू. दिस कॉजेज अनइक्वल फोर्सेज अप्लाइड ऑन टू ब्रेक शूज. To overcome this, we have a modified version in the form of twin leading drum brakes. In this version, both shoes act as leading shoes. Let us go into details. Twin leading drum brakes. There are two wheel cylinders. Piston in each cylinder pushes individual brake shoe. As shown in the diagram, these are located in upper and lower portion. Brake shoes have been anchored separately on anchor pins on upper and lower side, as shown. These can move about anchor pins. Two wheel cylinders and piston assemblies operate brake shoes independently, as already mentioned. Wheel cylinder on upper side is supplied with fluid. It pushes piston towards right, causing brake shoe on right to move about anchor pin located in lower portion. Movement of brake shoe brings brake lining in frictional contact with inner surface of wheel drum. Similarly, piston in lower cylinder is pushed by fluid. This causes pushing of brake shoe on left outwards. Brake shoe moves about anchor pin located on upper side. This brake shoe also comes in frictional contact with inner surface of wheel drum. It may be noted here that both brake shoes are operated simultaneously. Frictional contact causes resistance to motion. As may be noticed, piston in upper cylinder moves towards right and in lower cylinder it moves towards left. As pistons in cylinders are moving in opposite directions, both brake shoes in this case are leading brake shoes. Both brake shoes produce torque of same magnitude. When automobile moves in reverse direction, both brake shoes become trailing brake shoes. Duo servo drum brakes. These have an adjusting screw. As can be seen in diagram, it is located on lower side between two shoes. Both brake shoes are anchored on single anchor pin on upper side. These are also connected with anchor pin block through separate springs. Third spring on lower side connects the two brake shoes, and so the name connecting spring. In this brake, trailing shoe is known as primary shoe, whereas leading shoe is known as secondary shoe. When secondary shoe is pushed and comes in contact with forward moving drum, it rotates partially with drum due to friction. This produces movement that is conveyed to primary shoe through adjusting screw, and it comes in contact with drum. This is a self-energizing action and creates an additional resistance to motion, termed as additional because it supplements force exerted on brake shoes by pistons in wheel cylinder. Initially, piston in wheel cylinder moves secondary shoe only. This is done by providing strong return spring to primary shoe. This minimizes delay in self-energizing action. Also known as self-energizing brakes, they have high effectiveness. Their effectiveness reduces sharply with decrease in coefficient of friction due to brake lining wear. In drum brakes, distance between brake shoe and drum is very crucial. It affects the effectiveness of brakes. In old days, drum brakes required adjustment of this distance periodically, and this was done manually. In present times, we have self-adjusting drum brakes. Referring to diagram of leading trailing drum brakes, adjusting screw is operated with the help of a lever. A rod or cable is used to operate this lever. This way, distance between drum and brake shoe is adjusted. This is done automatically in most of the cases, though others may require manual operation. Referring to the diagram of twin leading drum brake, here also it is done in similar manner. Disc brakes. Disc brakes have disc naturally. It rotates with road wheel. Resistance to motion occurs when calipers come in frictional contact with disc. These calipers are provided with frictional surfaces that act as brake shoes. This type of brake can be very easily seen in today's motorcycles. Not every motorcycle has disc brake, but if you come across a motorcycle with disc brake, you can easily locate it in front wheel. You will see a metallic disc with calipers at its outer edge. Maybe it comes to your notice that disc is perforated. It has holes through it. These holes facilitate transfer of heat to surroundings. This heat is generated because of friction when brakes are applied. Disc brakes find most common use in the front wheels of cars. In some cars, disc brakes are used in rear wheels also. As mentioned earlier, it is a single disc with friction pads. These friction pads are much smaller as compared to brake shoes in drum brakes. Because of small size of friction pads, temperature rise due to friction is less. This improves anti-fade characteristics of brakes. These brakes are classified as number 1 fixed caliper disc brake and number 2 floating caliper disc brake. Fixed caliper disc brake. The disc in the middle of calipers rotate as already mentioned. Referring to diagram that shows assembled view, disc on its both sides has pistons with friction pads mounted on them. Pistons can have to and fro motion inside cylinders. Initially, brake is not applied and friction pads do not have any contact with disc. Disc is freely rotating. As shown, when brake is applied, fluid flows in both cylinders and pushes pistons. One on left-hand side moves towards right, bringing friction pad in contact with disc. Similarly, piston on right moves towards left and friction pad comes in contact with disc. Friction pads have frictional contact on both sides of disc. This causes resistance to motion and braking action occurs. In this type of brake, caliper is fixed. Floating caliper disc brake. It is quite similar to fixed caliper disc brake. Only difference being that in this type of disc brake, caliper can also move horizontally. Referring to diagram, piston is only on right hand side. It has friction pad mounted at the end as shown. Other friction pad is mounted on caliper end on left hand side. When brake is not applied, friction pad on caliper end is not in contact with disc but it is close to it. As shown, fluid flows in cylinder when brakes are applied. This pushes piston towards left and pad comes in frictional contact with disc. As reaction, caliper moves towards right and friction pad mounted on it comes in frictional contact with disc. In this manner, both friction pads create resistance to motion through friction. When brake is released, piston moves outwards and frictional contact between pad and disc is lost. Similarly, caliper moves towards left and contact between pad and disc is lost. Parking brake. It is a part of brakes, referring to diagram of leading trailing drum brakes. You may notice parking brake lever on right hand side. This lever causes movement of brake shoe on right to move outward and attain frictional contact with wheel drum. This causes resistance to motion and brake is actuated. Hand brake lever pulled by driver causes this actuation. Parking brake, as the name indicates, is applied when vehicle is stationary or parked. Frictional force causing resistance is not very high, but sufficient to prevent movement of stationary vehicle. Parking brake cannot be used when vehicle is moving. They are not capable of producing sufficient resistance to stop moving vehicle. Referring to the diagram of twin leading drum brake, here also you may notice similar parking brake lever on right hand side. In a similar manner as explained in previous diagram of leading trailing drum brake, it is operated with hand brake lever pulled by driver. Application of parking brake ensures that parked vehicle stays in its place and does not move, particularly on declining roads in hilly areas. In addition to parking brake, to prevent rolling of vehicle, locking pin is provided. This pin can be operated through gear lever. Pin locks gear wheels in their place and prevents their rotation. By operating gear lever, pin is unlocked and gear wheels can rotate. This system works in combination with parking brakes essentially. Parking brake is engaged first and then gears are locked. If not used with parking brake, it may cause stress on transmission system that is not desirable. Parking brake components. Parking brakes have got following components. Number 1, lever to engage parking brake, which is also known as hand brake lever. This lever is inside the driver cabin and driver can operate it conveniently while sitting on driving seat. Number 2, steel cable connecting the lever with parking brake lever inside both wheels on rear side. It is in shape of Y. A single cable connects the hand brake lever. Then it splits into two and connects both rear wheels. This gives cable Y shape. A simple diagram will help to understand it in better manner. Two views including elevation of lever has been drawn on left hand side. Lever is pulled upward to engage parking brake. Lever is pushed downwards to disengage parking brake. Lower view presents the Y steel cable connected to lever on left hand side. Two arms of Y connect the two parking brake levers in rear wheels. When lever is pulled upwards, this causes pulling of cable towards left as indicated by arrow. This brings brake shoes in contact with drums in two rear wheels and brake is engaged. Pushing lever downwards causes movement of cable towards right and parking brake is disengaged. As mentioned, cable operates parking brake lever that causes the contact between brake shoe on right with drum. Frictional resistance thus caused is sufficient to keep vehicle stationary when parked. Parking brake can be operated in different ways. One way that is explained above is center lever type. Parking brake lever or hand brake lever is located in the center between two front bucket seats. Alternatively, parking brake can be operated through electric switch. This electric switch is provided in console. By pushing the switch, parking brakes are engaged. Releasing switch disengages parking brakes. In vehicles with automatic transmission system, parking brake is disengaged automatically when drive or reverse is selected. These are the two positions in transmission system that allow the movement of vehicle. Here I conclude the discussion for present lecture. Thanks for watching.